sitting in Hawaii and soaking up the sun and swimming in the swimming pool and going to the beach and just enjoying, you know, life and family. This is definitely a family gathering place.
I never had, well, I probably had dreams, but I never dreamt that I one day would own a big ship or maybe a little fishing boat. Could have been in my dreams, but nothing big, no.
Well, Corey was, I figured he was one of the biggest blessings that ever come into my life. I think we all worked hard. We saw other people work just as hard as we did and take risks. And neither one of us can take credit for all the success we have. I think it's been at the right place at the right time. God blessed us with great people.
I've always been a little envious of those guys in that era because they were the true pioneers.
We started in 1973, and I think our first year we had $3 million in sales, and this year we're going to be not quite a billion, pretty close.
This is Hawaii, the big island of Kona, January 2008. Kaare Ness and some of the Trident Seafood employees are gathered at Chuck Bundrant's home to recall some historic highlights of their successful company. The house is located just across the bay from James Cook's monument, where he was killed at Kealakekua Bay in 1779 after a short visit to the Aleutian Islands in Alaska. Kaare Ness was born on another island, geographically located 11 time zones and 8,000 miles east of Hawaii, on the west coast of Norway, the land of the Vikings, with beautiful fjords along a long coastline, great waterfalls, and many glaciers just a short distance from the island of Karmøy, where Kaare Ness was born in 1928.
This little town is 150 years old this year, and this was one of the big shipping towns in the olden days. I had a lot of sailing vessels out of there, and most of the people that came here and started, they came out of Stavanger. I remember when we were kids, you know, all them houses up through this street here was called, the street is called Kirkegaten. I grew up in this area of the island. This was out in the countryside when we grew up here. We had a pretty good childhood. We didn't have any worries, really. We were a big family. We were 9 kids in the family. We had a 3-room schoolhouse here, and we went to school every other day, including Saturday was a school day too, so we, in other words, we went to school 3 days a week when we were kids. There was about 120 kids that belongs to this local school here. But then the Germans came and occupied Norway, and of course a lot of soldiers came, so they took all the schools, which happened in 1940. I was in 4th grade when that happened, and that was the end of our schooling. Of course, I was confirmed in 1943. I was almost 15, and then we went to work. The work here was fishing. There was no industry of any kind. There was a shortage of everything. There was nothing to buy, really, although you had money, but everything was in short supply. Food, clothing, whatever you needed, there wasn't much to get.
I was never hungry. What we liked, we had. Fish and herring and oatmeal. We had this little farm, you know, we planted the potatoes and corn. And so I don't think we went hungry.
So after the war ended in 1945, I went in the Merchant Marine.
1949, I was up on Iceland for 3 months. And we came home, never get a dime, because we didn't get any herring that year. So I spent three months up on Iceland, never saw 1 crown.
I think I started thinking about that when I was thinking about getting myself a house. And I couldn't see any opportunities here to get enough money together. And of course, this area, especially on the west side of the island, there was hundreds of people that over the years had left for the States. My idea was to go to the States, be there a couple, 2-3 years, come back home, build that house I was dreaming of getting, and I told my wife, if you don't like it, we go back home.
So then we were going to stay for 2 years, and it ended up 6 before we went home. Oh, that was a long time.
My dad went to the States before me in 1952, and my dad, he never stayed over a winter in the United States. He came in the spring and went back to Norway just before Christmas ever. For all the years, he went forth and back. People around here were used to be going away from home. Away from home wasn't such a big thing. But most of the people had a small farm, a couple of cows and some other animals. And the ladies were the ones that took care of all of that stuff, beside the kids, because the men was gone so much. And the money was short. It was mostly poor people around here. There was no rich people there. Most of them were very poor. Some of the ladies, even the one that probably had a little barn and some animals, they worked in the fish houses after the season was over, because all this herring they salted in the winter fishing, they processed it during the spring and summer. And that was the woman that did that. So my mother, although she had a big family, she worked in the fish houses. You had the winter fishery on the coast for herring, and you had the Iceland fishery, which took place in the summer. So they were the two main fisheries, and there was absolutely no other work around here. The only people working here was the teacher and a few handful of people that was working on the roads. There was no industry here. Nothing.
Det var lite arbeid å få. Båtene lå ved kajen, og silla var ikke å sjå. Og silla var ikke å sjå.
In 1950, the herring resources started to diminish in the North Sea. Herring, the lifeline of so many towns along the coast of Norway and Iceland, was starting to be overfished. It was the beginning of poor economic times for the fishermen on Karmøy. Many of them decided to emigrate to the United States, where the opportunities were much better.
Most of them went to New Bedford, Massachusetts. I had an uncle there, my father's brother. He had left Norway in 1928. He had never been home since he left. We fished scallops all the time, which is a shellfish. I was there 13 years, and the only fishing I did was scallops.
Well, I think the Norwegians came to this area and got involved in the fishing industry, and they were very, very instrumental in bringing it to the level of organization that is here. The Seafood Producers was a group that was influential in starting the advertising and the promotion of scallops. That was largely Norwegians that were members of it, not all.
We made good money, we thought, compared to what we had made in Norway. We thought we were just fortunate to make that much money. You know.
I think it was around 1960, my father bought another boat. He already had one, he bought a second boat, and he needed a captain. And he knew Cora and saw potential in him and asked Cora if he would be interested in being the captain of that boat for him. And the name of the boat was the Louise. Cora ran the boat for my dad and did such a good job that he had an opportunity to become partners in a new boat, which he did and ran that and from there moved to Alaska where there was a scallop fishery being developed there.
And I made a trip out there because king crab was big in them days. And then on the way home, I stopped in Kodiak, Alaska, because I heard somebody was fishing scallops up there. So I saw the scallop boat, and they brought the scallops in the shell. It was kind of a Mickey Mouse thing. But I talked to some of the fish buyers up there. They said, well, if you like to come out there and do a scallop charter, they didn't know what resource was there.
There was like seven or eight boats that went west, and the Viking Queen, which was the boat that Cora owned, was one of them. And the rest of the story with Cora is just tremendous.
We started a company up in Seward, Alaska, where we processed our own scallops and trying to sell it, but it was hard to sell, you know. And the government, they used to buy scallop, the military. But funny enough, you know, the Alaskan scallop had a different Latin name than the East Coast scallops. And the government, they bought the scallops under the Latin name, so they wouldn't buy Alaska scallop because it had a different Latin name.
And the reality was, you know, that he's still, I think that's probably the first evidence or the first notion that I had, you know, that he wasn't meant to stay, you know, in the mainstream, you know, that he had bigger ambitions than that. And, you know, for him to go out there first, you know, and fish, was one thing. It was kind of like him being on an extended fishing trip. But when he's talking about moving business and family, it was like, that was fairly substantial, I thought, you know.
After arriving in Alaska, Kaare Ness got acquainted with a person who would have an enormous impact on his future, Chuck Bundrant, a very successful, hardworking fisherman with a lot of drive and energy, according to Kaare. Together, they were to play an important part in the 1970s gold rush in the Bering Sea and Pacific Ocean of Alaska.
I didn't see him again. That was in 68. I think next time I met him was probably in 69 or maybe early 1970, I'm not quite sure. We were both fishing then. I was fishing crab too then. And I met Chuck again doing fishing way out on the Aleutian chain. Chuck had gotten his first new boat by that time. I could see there was more opportunities in crab and scallops.
Corey contacted me in 1971, I think, and asked me if I'd be interested in being his partner in a crab boat.
So we became partners in that first boat that I built, which was the Royal Viking, which was one of the bigger boats at that time. It was 108 feet, and was built new in Seattle. So the following year, I'm going to build a boat too, he said, and go back fishing. It's going to be a different kind of a boat. It's going to be a boat that is going to be fishing and processing the product on board. And that was the start of Trident Seafood.
When I built the Billiken, that was the first catcher processor. And everybody said it wouldn't work, but we proved them wrong, and it worked very well. And that was really the financial success. And we were off to the races after we built the Billiken. We later built the Bountiful. And they expanded into production facilities like the Mr. J and the Tempest, big processing ships that today we process well over 1 billion pounds of seafood per year. In 1976, the Magnuson-Stevenson pass pushed our limits out to 200 miles. That was a major turning point in the United States fisheries. On the East Coast, they had already damaged the fisheries quite severely, and putting a very good dent in the fisheries in the West Coast, but in Alaska. But fortunately for us, the resource rebounded back.
Early on, there was a lot of king crabs all over. We fished from Kodiak and all the way almost to the end of Aleutian chain. In the late 70s, early 80s, there was hardly any king crab left. So they fished it down or fished it out, and some of the areas were closed. And so compared to what it used to be in the big days, the king crab fishing today is a small fishery.
And I think both Corey and I caught the heyday of the king crab business and the paleo business in Alaska. And instead of spending money foolishly, we put all our money back into our boats and our equipment and continued to expand through the years. And then diversification, which saved our bacon when the crab business collapsed in the late 80s, early 80s, I should say. We were in the salmon business and the herring business by that time, and were able to survive during the 80s in salmon and herring.
A lot of guys, the ones that economically could change, they changed over to bottom fishing. So we changed over some of our boats. There was a big resource up there of bottom fish, which was in them days caught by mostly the Japanese and the Russians.
I think all of these guys had the unique ability to run a boat, to handle any plumbing problem or issue, mechanical issue or hydraulic issue or electronic issue on any one of these vessels out here, and still have the capacity to work the politics and the financing and the business end of a large corporation.
In 1984 or 5, me and Chuck was the owner of the Royal Viking Company. So we sold it into Trident. So Royal Viking today is a company that is owned by Trident Seafoods. I had fished all the way up till 1981 every year. But at that time, I couldn't see I could manage the boats and fish at the same time. So I decided, well, I will stop fishing, but I will manage the boats.
I don't know if he was 60 or, you know, then he quit fishing and he worked down, you know, in the office down there. And that was, I was relieved then, you know. And I think since my dad, that happened to him, you know, this big sea, you know, took and threw him overboard and, you know, then they got Indian trouble and they didn't, so he was lost up there.
Well, Trident today is it's a pretty big company in the fishing business. It has been getting bigger over the years because Trident has bought up other companies as they went along. One big purchase was Tyson Seafoods. Some years ago, they had a lot of fishing vessels, some factory ships, and some shore plants.
Over the last two decades, fishing has changed dramatically. The quantity of fish and crab that is permissible to catch is highly regulated and is part of the ownership of a boat. With huge factory ships and modern efficient equipment to catch the fish, the resource needs to be controlled, or the fishermen could quickly deplete the resource and damage their own future livelihood, as happened to herring in Norway and king crab in the 1970s. Management of the fish resources in Alaska is essential for the future of Trident and their competitors.
If they hadn't got this thing under control, you know, there wouldn't be any fish left, I don't think. The managers is the one that has to control the fishery, not the fishermen, because fishermen take the last fish if they can. In Alaska, I think they probably had the best management any place in the world on their resources.
Coming from the fishing grounds, it's not the typical set of attributes that a fisherman has. Now, he can be, you know, master of his own vessel. It's pretty easy if you got a 50-footer, you have components of everything. But taking that to multi-million dollar company level is something that is terrifying to most fishermen. And dealing with fishery politics, particularly at the congressional level, is something that makes people pretty uncomfortable. So it required a skill set that I don't think a lot of people were really capable of doing. And these guys had it and put it together, and it certainly worked for them to the point where you know, Trident developed its own shore-based capacity for pollock, made investments in Arctic Alaska Tyson fisheries that had offshore capacity. So they weren't afraid to move forward at a time when everybody knew there was going to be risk.
Jeg har jo som historieforteller og vise sanger skrevet og gått i fotfare etter mange av disse og skrevet historien deres. Det jo den moderne Espen Askeladd nærmest som en har her i levende liv i dag, som ble reist opp ifra de fattigslige fiskebondekårene på Karmøy nå, og til det som en opplever og ser hva de karene har gjort og fått det her i Amerika. Det fantastisk.
Trident owns and operates a modern fleet of 30 vessels, but when Kaare and Chuck travel to visit their operations in Alaska, their ride is on a corporate jet. The group consists of a few of Trident's top management team. The focus of Trident's commercial fishing and primary processing operations continues to be in Alaska and the North Pacific, where long-term dedication to conservative, science-based management has maintained healthy, sustainable fisheries for decades.
The opportunity is primarily the Bering Sea itself, one of the healthiest ponds, I guess you could call it, left in the world.
The plane is headed for Dutch Harbor, situated on one of the islands in the Aleutian chain. Here, a little different ride is waiting to take the group onto Akaton Island, in the middle of the Bering Sea, which, while remote, is no small outpost. Trident's multi-species processing plant on Akaton employs 900 workers and is the largest fish processing plant in North America.
Akaton would be the second largest fishing port in the United States if they were allowed to really report the landing figures there. But due to confidentiality on a regular basis, they can't when it's operating at full capacity. It processes 3 million pounds of pollock on a daily basis. It's really a huge facility, and it can process multi-species at the same time. That is probably the biggest fish processing machine anywhere in this country. And it was carved out of a rock, and there was nothing there before.
I think the most rewarding that I get a satisfaction out of is watching young people grow into mature, grown, successful entrepreneurs and fishermen. The superintendent in Akaton started out as a process worker. worked his way up, and he got into the galley and worked his way up to the galley as the head cook, and then they took and moved him from the cook into foreman. And the foreman, they went into the night superintendent, from the night superintendent to the day superintendent. Now he's the general superintendent of the world's largest fish plant, and doing a marvelous job. The people love him, the employees love him, the fishermen love him.
About 50 of us have been here over 15 years. And then there's another 200 people that has been here over 10 years, and another 300-400 that have been with us for 3 to 5 years. So the turnover is very little, and we get a lot of return employees all the way from all levels. They're from all over the world, from every continent, Europe, Africa, Asia, Central America, United States. We have always promoted from within.
It is early morning in Akaton, and the group needs to get back to Dutch Harbor, where the corporate jet is waiting to take them to Kodiak Island. This time, the ride is on one of Trident's fishing vessels. As Kaare, Chuck, and the crew are entering Dutch Harbor after an unusually smooth ride from Akaton, they arrive at the same time as one of their successful factory ships is returning from weeks in the Bering Sea. The young factory ship's skipper and manager and his crew greet the old veterans of the sea with respect and admiration. The factory ship has 128 employees on board. It has icebreaker capabilities.
As a result, I think they work harder and do a better job.
First of all, this is Kaare Ness, and have you met Chuck Bundrant?
Anytime you're following in the footsteps of legends like my father and Kaare Ness, it's full of challenges, but it's blessings as well. It's an amazing industry that we're in, and many, many opportunities to take this company and our resources to the next level.
Kaare and Chuck interviewed me the first time. I was just finishing up school, and I met Kaare first time, and he was at the Groundfish Forum, a big event in London. And he had caught the fact that I'd started working in a supermarket at the fish counter when I was 14, and he had caught the fact that I'd worked on factory trawlers. I had no idea who he was, so he said, "I want to fly you over to Seattle, meet with some more people, see if you like it, and if you do, we would like you to join the company. We don't want to hire you for 1 or 2 years. When we make the commitment, we also expect you will make the commitment. So when you join the Trident family, it's a good family, you're in for the long haul."
Hi, my name is Sig Hansen. I'm the captain and part owner of the fishing vessel Northwestern, and we participate in the crab fishing in the Bering Sea of Alaska. As far as getting into the fishing industry, it was kind of something that we were born into. You know, we were raised here in Seattle, Washington, but our family and our roots are from actually Karmøy in Norway. And my father and mother both grew up in the same town as Kaare Ness. I remember even as a kid, when my father would mention his name, wherever the conversation led to, if Kaare's name came up, it was always so much respect for his name, even back then. Even at a young age, when I started to realize who Kaare was, he wasn't flashy, and he never tried to impress anybody. He was very humble, and I think most of that generation was like that as well. Of course, you know, I know he's done quite well for himself, and at the same time, being able to stay grounded and keep that attitude is very important.
We really are a global company that reaches the four corners of the earth now, but we still feel like a family. And it's a bit eerie to be working in a global company that has a family feel to it. It it seems so anti-corporate.
Their commitment to this industry, again, is unparalleled. There's no one that comes even close to doing what they've done for the time frame. I mean, you have to remember, they became partners in 1973. This is 35 years of a great, solid partnership. And I'm proud to say that Arne Ness and I are partners in a fishing company today, and that partnership, I hope, will continue for the next generation, to our children.
I think in the later years, I probably think people see the value of seafood more than they did 10, 15 years ago, because it's a healthy food.
This boat was built in Seattle, 79, you know.
This boat, yeah, when it was converted, there really hasn't been much. The conversion went so well that there really hasn't been much modification since then.
No.
A couple of minor ones. No. The basics are the same. Hang on, we'll get Chuck in the picture here.
Visiting these processing facilities in Alaska is rewarding for Kaare and Chuck. Their 35 years of hard work have paid off for the veterans of the sea. The success of any food product begins with high-quality raw materials, which are provided just outside their processing plants. However, a high-quality processing facility is just as important. These are a few of the reasons why Trident products are sold by the best retailers and served in the best restaurants in the United States.
Corey's a little older than my dad, and maybe a little more gentle-spirited, but I think that they're both, they complement each other because they're two of the hardest working men I've ever met in my life. My dad and Corey both have always said, if you take care of your fishermen, you take care of your employees, and you take care of your customers, everything else will just take care of itself.
Corey is, they're so down to earth, and that's what I absolutely adore with them. You can walk into Trident Seafoods, and I mean, they're good for probably millions of tenfolds of dollars, but when you walk into the door in Trident, you wouldn't see the difference between Corey, Chuck, or any of our fishermen. It's just fascinating.
The thing that stands out with Corey is that if you want to write a book about a perfect partner, a guy that delivered all of his product to us, brought his expertise from the fishing side of the business, and his relationship with other fishermen and the respect that he has within the fishing community.
When I came to Alaska, it was in October 1974. I was sick and was unusable as a man, and so I began to work on land. Og på den tiden så bodde jeg i et telt. Sesongen begynte, jeg var bare med en uke for å flytte på noen teiner. Spørte Kåre hvis det ble en åpning en gang, om det var mulighet til å få jobb. Ja, vi får se, sånn. Men det var ingen som hadde sluttet der på flere år av mannskapet. Så lurte han på om jeg ville fiske, hvorfor jeg kan skjønne det, så jeg. Jeg tror det ligger i telt for å fryse og... Ja, men da må du gå opp og rive teltet, sa han, for vi drar om 3 timer. Jeg ble så glad, jeg sprang opp bakken, tårnet trillet. Så da var jeg lagmann i 3 år. Så det var sånn jeg fikk en god start på livet oppe i Alaska. Han har mye å takke for. En stor mann.
It stood beside me through thick and thin. And everything that we did wasn't perfect. And when I made mistakes, he was there to support me. He was there to celebrate with me when we did well, but there to pick me up when I did not so well.
Kåre har jo en fantastisk evne til å møte folk. Og han, Chuck er jo en fantastisk mann. Han sier jo at hvis det skal skrives en bok om hvordan samarbeid skal være, så skriver jeg en bok om han Kaare Ness.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain.
Kaare is home in Norway every summer visiting now. The long hours at sea are over.
Coming from Norway and understanding, you know, what summer means in Norway has probably been a great benefit to Kaare, because it's programmed into his brain that that he's going to take some time off. Chuck, I think, is has been driven for so many years that now I think maybe some of Corey's capacity to relax has finally rubbed off on Chuck, and he certainly earned some time away from the wheel and the pilot house and the desk or whatever you want to call it. So we're happy to see that. It's tough to envision anybody else at the helm.
I truly feel blessed to have a partner like Kaare, who walks his talk. He's never been judgmental of me or anything that I've ever done, but he's set a very good role model in his conduct in life as a husband and as a father and as a business partner. Couldn't ask for a better role model than Kaare Ness. He's my hero, my partner. A guy I'm glad to call my best friend.
When life's at its best, but in the valley.
I think immigrants, you know, which he is, they're a special breed. You know, most of the time, if a person is willing to leave a country, you know, a family that offers you know, a nurturing environment and is comfortable, and for those individuals to go someplace else and try to make something of themselves, it says something about that individual. It's a hardy stock, and you know, I mean, you know, to be a little dramatic about it, you know, I guess it goes back to the Viking stock, you know, from many, many, many generations ago, and there's some of that in those genes and in that blood, and I think he's done very, very well, you know, for himself and his family. And for us to all be able to enjoy him at this ripe old age, you know, we relish every day with him and my mother and the family, and we are a close family, and we love each other and we love being with each other.
Det kommer litt skjevt ut i samfunnet, gjør de et godt arbeid for. Ja. Jeg har vært med å støtte arbeidet der, altså.
Friends are gathered to help care for the less fortunate people in society. Kaare and Sigrun enjoy getting involved and are supporting this initiative and also the church. In 1988, the Seattle Fisherman Memorial dedicated this bronze and stone monument to the men lost at sea working out of Seattle. It is a place of reverence, recognition, and healing for the families of more than 675 local commercial fishermen and women who have lost their lives.
There's a picture of my nephew that was killed up in Alaska on the 5th of January. He was on a boat there and fell off a stack of crab pots.
In New Bedford, there is another memorial to fishermen lost at sea.
The navigator, there was a scallop that was lost in 1977. And one of the guys on there, they were mostly Americans on that boat, but one guy, that Paul Rodriguez, I fished with that guy for years. So he was lost. That boat was lost with all hands. You see Midnight Sun, 11-19-62. There was 11 men there, and 10 of them came from Karmøy. Olav, he was, we went to school together, same class.
The ocean has taken many lives through the years. Fishing has been, and still is, a dangerous occupation. Kaare Ness and some of his colleagues have raised a memorial on Karmøy, just a few hundred meters from the town of Okra, where he grew up.
I think there's 102 names on there. Of course, fishing always been dangerous. On there is two big accidents where there was 11 people on one and 12 on another. And they were all here from Karmøy, like the one with 12, 11 of them were. From Karmøy, there was only one American on there. And on the other one there, there was 11, and they were all from this island. So a lot of the big accidents that happened was on scallop boats, where they were big crews. Both of them were lost in big storms. One was in a big hurricane in 1938. Where on that hurricane, I think there was over 600 people lost at sea on the east coast of the United States. I'm lucky just to not be on there, because I was rushed overboard one time from a fishing boat, and it was pretty serious because I can't even remember when they picked me up again. So I was pretty close to be one of them that could have been on here, one name that could have been there.
Jeg har jo snakket med de som var med å berge han, hvor han altså for under sjøen gang på gang på gang, og han var jo nærmest død når de fikk han opp på dekk. Skipperen hoppet jo på sjøen med lina rundt seg. Og han fikk jo en enorm kraft som han har levt på etter den. Det noe som har preget han, Kåre.
One favorite project is the Native Nikolai Church close to Chuck's place in Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Today is a special day for Kåre and Sigrun.
Sigrun, they will celebrate the 60th wedding anniversary in the month of July of 2009. Can we please give a warm welcome to Kaare Ness?
I want to tell you about a miracle that happened 49 years ago. As I was planning, I was thinking about my family. We had a little girl that was a little over a year old, and we had a son, about 8. And I thought, man, I was wondering what was going to happen to my kids and my wife. The next thing I knew, I was laying on the
deck of the boat, they had managed to pick me up. And the first thing I said, thank you, God, for saving my soul and saving me. I thank you all for giving me the opportunity to give my testimony of the day.
Sailed out from the roughest shore, with long fields and heather moors. From his childhood's land, he was a fisherman who learned early to fight against waves. But one day at Georgia's bank, he nearly was dead, but God took his hand instead. 'Cause he's the man that America needs, with his friend from Tennessee. They built this great fishing company from Alaska along the